The Panzer Mark VI, or Tiger I, also had its origins in the pre-war years. Hitler ordered the design of a heavy tank that would not only overcome the threat of the T-34, but capture the lead for the Germans in tank design. The design produced a 55-ton tank that was also manned by 5 crew members.
The crew of a Tiger consisted of the commander, who was in charge of the vehicle and selected targets. He also fired the turret machine gun. Next came the gunner, who sat next to the commander and targeted his enemies through his gun sights. In many respects, he was the most vital member of the crew. In battle, every shot had to count. The flight of a shell is affected by many factors, including wind direction, rain, snow, and other atmospheric conditions. The gunner had to gauge the range to the target, allow for any climatic factors, and compensate for the speed of any moving targets which were more difficult to hit. One miss could allow an enemy tank to get in the first vital shot, which spelled death in the tense tank duels of World War II. Positioned on the opposite side of the turret from the gunner was the loader. He did the heavy manual work of loading the gun. After each engagement, he also had the laborious job of emptying the shell cases and restocking the tank with the cumbersome rounds for the main gun. Inside the hull, towards the front of the vehicle, sat the driver. On his right was the radio operator, who fulfilled the vital communications function. He also manned the hull machine gun.
The main gun was the 88mm L-56 gun that first saw use as an anti-aircraft weapon. This gun was extremely potent and was capable of defeating any tank that it came up against, and often at ranges of up to 2,000 meters. The main armament was backed up with 2 machine guns.
This is the bow machine gun. It was operated by the radio operator, who was down here in the hull. So in addition to his communication jobs, he had to man a machine gun. Now, machine guns are notorious for jamming, so it wasn't a simple task. It had to be reloaded by one man, all jams had to be cleared, and at the same time, he was trying to stay in communication with all the other tanks in the battalion and relay messages to his commander and take messages from his commander and pass them on.
The huge weight of the Tiger and its rush development both posed problems for its crews.
This is the driver's viewing slit. As you can see, it's not particularly a big area, but for an armoured vehicle, there is a real danger that a shell could come flying in here. So in action, this metal visor was lowered, and the driver had to rely on a periscope which exited from these two little visors in the front of the tank. One of the good features of the Tiger were these wide tracks. Now, it had those for two reasons. First of all, the vehicle was so heavy at 56 tons that you need something to spread the weight and lower the surface area. But in addition, in combat over mud and snow, the kind of conditions you would expect to find in Russia, these gave the tank much more mobility than any of the previous German models. As you can see, this is not something that's going to be easy to change. So if for any reason the tank loses a track, it was the devil's own job for the crew to be able to put the tracks back together again. And really, they more often than not had to rely on either other tanks to come along and help with that procedure, or hope that they could be dragged off the battlefield and repaired behind the lines. If they had to attempt to change them, they weigh a ton, they're difficult to change, and it was certainly a task that the crew wouldn't relish in any shape or form.
The Tiger first saw action at Leningrad in 1942. The results were poor due to inadequate infantry protection and poor deployment. The Russians were able to knock the tanks out by aiming at the tracks. The Germans quickly learned their lesson, and future use of the Tiger I was carefully managed. The first large employment of the tank was at Kursk, when approximately 100 were used. Almost half of these were issued to the elite formations of the Waffen-SS and the Gross Deutschland Division. The Tiger I quickly earned a fearsome reputation against all of its foes. The tank only saw action for 2 years, but its reputation still stands today.